King Saul was chosen of God to be the king for Israel. He was in his position of authority, he was ruling, and he was reigning. But when it came to the threats and taunts of the Philistines, he was looking amongst his mighty men to see who it is that could conquer the Philistines' chosen warrior. And whoever would conquer that chosen warrior, the Philistines named Goliath, would win the battle. Rather than losing thousands and thousands of men, they decided to make it easier. Let's just choose our greatest warrior, and whoever wins out there wins the battle. And the Philistines had a giant, I mean a complete total beast of a man. And King Saul was intimidated by this and couldn't find anyone that would volunteer to take on Goliath. And we all know the story of the young man David, who many years before was actually anointed king by Samuel the prophet. Even though David was anointed to be king, he wasn't functioning in his role or office. And so he probably just said, well, I'm just going to do what is in front of me to do. It's just not there right now. Thanks, Samuel, for the anointing, but I don't see that position. There's already a king for Israel. When David goes out and he takes on Goliath, and Goliath, you know, ends up being killed, and we see young David taking the head of Goliath and sticking it on a post and letting everyone know that the enemies of Israel will always be defeated, the people rallied around David. They honored David. They celebrated over David. David had this authenticity and sincerity in his relationship with God. There was something really unique about David. And Saul, rather than celebrating David's victory, rather than rejoicing with David, rather than thanking God for this young man, you know, over the course of time, Saul grew extremely jealous and envious of David. Even multiple times, Saul would reach for a spear and fling it at David and run him out of the palace and plot and scheme to take David's life. Rather than Saul seeing David as a resource, as a gift, as someone he can invest into, Saul saw David as a threat and wanted David out of the picture. He did not like the chance of the people that loved David more than Saul, that talked about how David killed tens of thousands, but Saul only killed thousands. I mean, Saul grew jealous and envious and wanted all of the power to himself. He wanted to micromanage his kingdom. He wanted to rule his kingdom with his own wisdom and strength. And anyone that would threaten him, anyone that would take the limelight from him, anyone that would outshine him or outperform him, Saul squashed it. Saul threw spears at it. There's no way Saul was willing to allow that to happen. And so David became a professional spear dodger. I mean, he knew how to get out of the way of it, till the point where David's like, man, Saul's going to kill me real soon. So David actually flees from Saul and lives in caves for some time to hide out from Saul. And Saul had ordered his military to find David and murder David, because he wanted all threats of his kingship to be removed. And you remember the story when Saul and his military were out looking for David. They camp out somewhere, I can't remember what the name of the place was, and Saul had to use the restroom. And so he goes into the cave and he's relieving himself, and he didn't realize that King David at that time, who wasn't king, but he was hiding out in that same cave. And David had the opportunity, while Saul was vulnerable, to slay Saul and take the kingdom by force. But what does David do? He cuts the hem of Saul's garment. And when Saul goes back out with his military, he tells everybody, like, I could have wiped out Saul there and then. I had the opportunity one-on-one with Saul to jump him and wipe him out and take the kingdom by force. But you know what David did? He repented that he even touched the hem of Saul's garment. He realized something, that God put Saul in place, not man, not flesh. And David didn't want to touch God's anointed. And I really want to encourage you that are listening out here today, that God has put these different leadership around us. God's put these leaders in their positions. The same God that put them there is the same God that can remove them from there as well. God doesn't need our help removing those types of people that would be out there just to tear down and only to build themselves up. God will allow their kingdom to go for a certain length of time, and sometimes we wonder sometimes why the wicked prosper, you know, why these ingenuine people are prospering. But believe me, just like it ended for Saul, it will not end well for those that are fake or for those that are counterfeit or for those that are not genuine in the call that's on their lives. They just are shrewd business people and have learned to make money off of ministry. That doesn't always work. But here's the deal, my friends. God has called us to take our eyes off people, to take our eyes off of kings, to take our eyes off leaders, to take our eyes off of individuals, and to fix our eyes on Him. David found a secret to success that we can all tap into. He had a relationship with God that was so beautiful. When you read the Psalms and you see how he poured out his heart, he poured out his pain, he poured out his grief, he poured out his frustrations, he poured it all out onto God so that he never took matters into his own hands. And I want to encourage you, God does not want any of us to take matters into our own hands. It is best to go to God. It is best to pray through things than take matters into our own hands. As we live in an attitude of supporting leadership, of speaking positive words over our leadership, of living it with an attitude of surrender to God and yieldedness to His will, yieldedness to His direction, without maligning anyone, without coming out and naming anybody, without having to be the person that exposes the sins of this person or that person, the best thing to do is to go to God in prayer. Slander never helps anybody. Bitterness doesn't help anybody. Bitterness only hurts the person that's bitter. It doesn't hurt anyone else. So as we are walking this journey out, we will get hurt. We will at some point intimidate people. At some point maybe people will feel like we're competition to them, and it's not our intention to be competitive. But as long as we keep our hearts open to what God has for us to do, as long as we stay in an attitude of, God, I don't want any hardness. I don't want any callousness in my heart. I don't want to be bitter. I don't want to be angry. I don't want to have anything towards anybody. I just want to follow after you. I just want to follow after your will and direction for my life. And even come to the point where we can pray blessings on those that would try to harm us. Even Jesus said, love those that would despitefully use you. He said, do good to them. Be kind to them. It's easy to love those that will love us back. It's harder to love those that would despitefully use us and even abuse us. And I want to encourage you, my friends, is that as we go on this journey, we're all going to be exposed to that type of experience. We're all going to feel that somewhere along the journey. Every single one of us will feel that, whether it's in a place of employment, whether it's in the place of ministry, whether it's in our families. We're all going to feel it at some point or another. But here's the warning: we can't let it take root in our lives. If we let it take root in our lives, we'll be ineffective to be evangelists. We'll be ineffective to be a light in our community. We've got to stay surrendered and stay open to God's leading and direction for our lives, and say to God, God, I will not speak against your servants. I will not speak against your leadership. Even though I'm going through all of these types of things, even though I'm not getting the push forward or the encouragement or the hand up that I need right now, God, I speak your word of blessing over them. I speak your word of generosity over them. Listen, don't feel like reciprocation is needed. Don't feel entitled to reciprocation. Give and then give and then give again. Keep extending a right arm of fellowship and blessing and support. You can give without having to put trust in that person so that they won't hurt you anymore. But we don't have to harbor or hold in any type of bitterness or resentment. I want to encourage you, when it comes to evangelism, it's going to be tough. We're going to face rejection. There's people that are not going to want to hear what we have to say. There's people that aren't going to believe in what we are doing. But here's the bottom line. Are we doing what God's telling us to do? And if we are, then let's not be intimidated. Let's not compete. Let's not compare. Let's not feel like, man, oh gosh, I can't do this. No, follow after God. You know, Saul could have just founded his confidence in that God put him where he was at. Instead, he found his confidence in what people thought of him, and he was more concerned about what people thought of him than what God thought of him.